இன்ட்ரோடக்ஷன்
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Dr. Amrit Lal. I'm spine surgeon at Vikram Hospital. I head the spine unit, and with deep pleasure I'm announcing that we have finished 10 years of setting up the spine unit and 10 years of setting up of Vikram Hospital in Bangalore. And it's a good feeling that we have come so far in all these years. So today's talk is on a very interesting way of treating low back pain and radicular pain. So the commonest cause, as you know, is a lumbar disc herniation, which results in pain going down the leg. And many treatment options are available, but some of them are prolonged medications, or there is surgery which has its own inherent risks, even though it is safe, but it has its own inherent risks. So interestingly, there are ways of treating it with less medication and without a surgery by treating with certain injections, what we know as the selective nerve root blocks. So I'll start the presentation now. Yeah, so selective nerve root blocks as an effective method of pain relief in lumbar disc herniation. So even for general practitioners, physicians, as well as in the emergency department or any other regular hospital setting, has a fair amount of people with back pain presenting to the doctors. And many of them turn out to be because of a lumbar disc herniation. The areas we would discuss is that of an introduction into lumbar disc herniation. We'd look at the pathophysiology of the radicular pain, some treatment options that are available, and we'd go deeper into what is a selective nerve root block and how do we do a patient selection and what are the expected outcomes. So starting with the anatomy, as we all know, cervical, thoracic, lumbar and sacral spine are the four parts. Of course, there's the coccyx, which is the lowermost part, which is the fifth segment of the spine. Between two vertebrae, you have the soft material called as the disc, which has an annulus, fibrosis in the periphery, and the nucleus pulposus, which is a soft crab meat like material, which is in the center, a jelly like material. There are nerves which are in close relation to the disc as well as to the joints. There are the facet joints, which are in the posterior lateral aspect, and there is the foramen on the side through which the individual nerve roots come out. The dural sac, which has the nerve roots within it, is surrounded by a strong bony structure as well as the cartilaginous or fibrocartilaginous structure, which is the disc. If you see the types of changes that that one can see in the spine with age, are that of degeneration of a disc. A normal disc would appear like this, as you see on top. Then you would see a degenerated disc, which would gradually start bulging out and there would be a herniation of the disc where the disc would balloon outwards and would press on the nerve roots. There can be, with age, there can be thinning of the disc. This thinning of disc effectively leads to shortening of the height of the foramen, the neural foramen here on the side. And as it dries up and thins out, there can be osteophytes which form. And you'll see these osteophytes, and that's what we call as spondylophytes. And these osteophytes are a sign of aging. It's not necessarily pathological unless these bony projections are pressing on the nerve roots posteriorly. So the different kinds of disc herniation are that of protrusion, extrusion, and sequestration. So what is pain? Pain is an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissue damage, or described in terms of such damage. This is what the IASP says. Now, interestingly, this is said to be the Pain Awareness Month, and so it's so appropriate that they're having this discussion on in this month. So that is back pain, whereas radicular pain or radiculitis. Radiculitis is from the Latin word radiculo, which is for root, and itis means inflammation. And radiculopathy is again radiculo, which is root, and Greek word meaning of pathos is suffering. So suffering due to a malady in the nerve roots. The radiculitis or radiculopathy is at or near the root of the nerve along the spinal cord. That means it is not outside the spinal cord. It is within, outside the spinal column, but it is within the spinal column, outside the dural sac. So if there's any compression or any inflammation of the nerve root, then it will lead to pain which is shooting down the leg, which is called as, which people commonly call as, the term as sciatica. So the symptoms of lumbar radiculopathy are typically radiating pain with tingling or pins and needles feeling in the lower limb, with difficulty in walking, lack of control, and also muscle weakness. So what happens when there is a pinched nerve? So the pinched nerve leads to inflammation of the nerve root, as you can see the red inflamed nerve root. The different ways in which a nerve root can get inflamed or pinched, the commonest one is that of a lumbar disc herniation. There is compression of the lumbar spinal nerve roots because of the disc bulging outwards and pressing on the nerve. Another common cause for nerve compression is spinal stenosis. So the spinal canal is this central part within the spinal column. There has to be adequate size of the spinal canal. There should be adequate space for the nerves. Now with aging, what happens is the facet joints get worn out and get thickened, and they start projecting into the spinal canal. There are also ligamentum flavum, which gets thickened and it makes it like a narrow canal. And there can also be a disc bulge, which also contributes as a result of degeneration, leading to effectively reducing the amount of space within the spinal canal. And that is what is termed as a spinal stenosis. And since the nerves are housed within the spinal canal, they get squeezed, leading to pain which is shooting down both the legs. Usually when there is pain which is going down both the legs, it's called as it's because of spinal stenosis. If it's on one, the pain is going only on one leg, then usually it's because of a disc herniation. Another cause of pain shooting down the leg is of a pinched nerve is a facet syndrome, where there is some problem within the facet joint. There may be a facet cyst, or during extension or hyperlordosis, the facet can project into the foramen, leading to compression of the nerve. And during flexion, the foramen size increases, leading to relief of the pain. So that is what we call as a facet syndrome. So pure, typically these individuals will have pain on lying down. They are okay during the day when they are walking. They may stoop forward a little bit and they get relief of pain. But when they lie down on their back in a supine position, there is extension of the spine, leading to compression of the nerve, because the facet joint, as you see here, is goes and presses on the nerve root. So what fundamentally, what is responsible for the pain? Yes, it is the pinched nerve. So there's a mechanical component to it. But at times, as you can see here in this MRI scan, you'll see a big disc which is pressing on the nerve roots. Now we know that there is a definite mechanical compression and that's what's causing the pain. But many a time, I come across individuals who have an MRI which looks like this, which is a very small disc bulge and not too significant a compression on the nerve roots. But still, they have typical sciatica type of leg pain. And what could be the reason for that when there is no real mechanical problem, mechanical compression? So the answer is that it may be inflammatory, because what happens with a ruptured disc is that the avascular nucleus is perceived as an antigen. That is, it is alien to the body. It's not to the immune system. So the immune system builds up an immune response, which leads to inflammation. And a lot of inflammatory products are released in that area, leading to pain. So the another cause is vascular, that is reduced blood flow to the dorsal root ganglion due to an increased perineural pressure. Then there is also the biochemical factors. There's increased phospholipase A2, prostaglandin E2, cytokines, and nitric oxide. These chemicals, when released, they are like a noxious stimulus to on the nerve and leading to pain. So if we can block these chemicals at the level of the nerve root, then the patient can get good pain relief. So the way to treat is there is conservative treatment and there is surgical treatment. So the conservative treatment means you restrict activities, give them limited bed rest for not more than 2 days, anti-inflammatory medications, oral steroids, but we wouldn't do conservative treatment if there is Cordyceina syndrome, where the person has loss of bowel and bladder symptoms, control, and if there is significant progressive neurological deficits. The medications are typically analgesics, anti-inflammatories, muscle relaxants, anticonvulsants, anti-anxiety agents, and antidepressants. There are a whole lot of medications which can be used for radicular pain. People do come back to me with my prescription saying, "Doctor, you've given me a medication which is an antidepressant, but I'm not depressed." So I have to explain to them that these medications also work for neuropathic pain or radicular pain. So these drugs can act at different levels. They can act at the cerebral level, at the level of perception, where opioids usually work, or they modulate in the pathway, which is what tramadol and tricyclic antidepressants do. Or at the point of transmission, at the root level, there are local anesthetics as well as opioids, ketamine and alpha-2 agonists, which can have can work at these levels. And at the level of transmission of the peripheral nerves, the you have local anesthetics and opioids. And then at the transduction level, where the nociceptors are available or free nerve endings are available, again the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications and the local anesthetics can work. So these are the different levels in which medications work. Surgical treatment would involve just removal of that part of the disc which is bulging out and pressing on the nerve. And with that, the person should feel relieved. So typically, when there is a herniated disc, as you can see at the L5-S1 level here, what we do is an endoscopic discectomy, where we use tubular dilators, where we do minimum small incision of only about 16 millimeters. And we go in and expose the required level and then put in a tube. This is a tube which is like a small funnel, and through which we do the work. We pass the instruments. This is an X-ray from the lateral view during the surgery to confirm our level, that it is indeed the L5-S1 that we have approached. And then we look through a microscope, and this is the disc material that you can see. And once we remove the disc material, you can see these are the nerve roots which are lying free. And you can see this nerve root, which is more red than the dural sac here. So this is the inflammation that I'm talking about. So there is significant inflammation, significant chemicals which are released inside the nerve roots, which lead to the pain response. And at the end of it, we remove the tubes, and you are left with a scar of about 16 millimeters and with a hospital stay of 1 day. But again, having said that, all these surgeries have their own share of risks. There's nerve injury, which is less than 1%. Fluid leak, the CSF, there can be a dural tear with this leak of the cerebrospinal fluid, which is again less than 1%. Risk of infection is approximately 1%. They can have back pain, which is transient, and again, it depends on the fitness of the person. And there can be wound pain, which is there in all patients. We'll have some post-surgical pain in the immediate post-operative period. So what are the what is there anything non-surgical which can be thought of? Now we come to the main crux of our topic, that is selective nerve root block. It involves injection of local anesthetic and corticosteroids around the spinal nerves. Here you can see in this image, these are the vertebrae, this is the foramen, and you pass a needle around the nerve root and inject steroid into the nerve roots, and that leads to reduction in inflammation and pain relief. McNabb was the first to describe a selective nerve root block in 1971. It was used as a diagnostic modality. I'll tell you why it was used as a diagnostic modality. It will come in the subsequent slide. Today, SNRB has shown to have diagnostic sensitivity of up to 100% for intervertebral disc prolapse. And it has a therapeutic effect that is now well established. And it helps is known to help in lumbar radicular pain secondary to IVDP. There are different routes in which you can pass a needle into the spinal canal. There is the epidural, the facet block, there is transforaminal epidural, there are discograms, there is nerve root block, and there is sympathetic ganglion block. What we are talking about is a selective nerve root block. So an epidural steroid would involve going through the midline and passing and injecting steroid around the dural sac. Or there is also the caudal epidural, where from the sacral hiatus, there is an opening in the sacrum at S4. From there, you pass in a channel, a catheter, and which is pushed all the way up till the L1, L2 level. And you can spray all the way down from L1, L2 level, all the way down to the sacral level. You can spray steroid around the on all the nerves. Now, that is something which I would use for post-operative pain, or in patients whom we don't, we cannot really, we find it difficult to target one particular nerve root. Then we would randomly spray. Whereas the selective nerve root block is, again, as I explained, you're selectively going on to one nerve root and then injecting the steroid on the nerve root. Is it really useful? It has found minimum, at least as a short-term pain-relieving technique, it gives up 50 to 85% of the patients have been found to have pain relief. So, you know the pathophysiology. It is not well understood, but we do know there's a mechanical component, inflammation, degenerative component, and at the inflammation component, you part of it, you have the steroids which work, which have an anti-inflammatory effect, and they block the arachidonic acid pathway, and they block the cytokines and TNF-alpha, which and the interleukins, which are released in the vicinity of the nerve roots, and thus giving pain relief. So what we do is we use a standard technique. That is, you pass the needle into the foramen, on the upper part of the foramen where the nerve root is sitting. So it should appear like this on anteroposterior view. This is a spinal needle, usually a 20 gauge spinal needle or an 18 gauge spinal needle. And it should be, this is the pedicle of the vertebra. You can see that it is medial to the, it is falling between the two pedicles. Lateral to the medial border of the pedicles, of a line connecting the upper and lower pedicle. It is lateral to that and medial to the lateral line. That is a line connecting the lateral edge of the two pedicles on AP. And on lateral, it appears like this, sitting right in the foramen. And then we inject a dye to make sure that the nerve root is visible, and that we are indeed under the nerve sheath on the nerve root. So this is a very good image showing the needle and the dye, and the dye has gone and tracked along the nerve root here, which is giving us a beautiful image of what we are trying to achieve. So the role of SNRB is of therapeutic use for pain relief, but it's also for diagnostic purpose. That is, it helps identify symptomatic nerve roots in patients with probable radicular pain that is not fully concordant with the imaging findings. That is, if you see this MRI image, there are so many vertebrae here, and between two vertebrae you have the discs, and these discs are bulging out. All of them are bulging out. So are we to think that all these nerve roots are, all these discs are causing, responsible for the pain, or is it only one particular nerve root? So what we do is we selectively keep injecting on one nerve root at a time and getting a feedback from the patient. The patient will be awake. It's done under local anesthesia. The patient will be awake, and we try to find out, they will express themselves as to, after the first injection, whether they've got relief. Then they go, then we inject into the next root, and we find out if they have had relief, and so on. We keep injecting roots one at a time. So the sensitivity of nerve root block is said to be 93.3%, which is very high, and specificity is about
25.6%. So the specificity is very low because sometimes there can be leakage of the steroid to other areas, and it may even block certain, even the lumbar plexus. It can even block the facet joint at times if we infiltrate a lot, or it can block other roots if it leaks and goes to the adjacent roots. And so we may think that it is the L4 root, but it may actually be the L5 root or the L3 root which has got blocked. So precision is very important. So in our hospital, we have followed up on our patients. I had injected over 6 years about 584 cases, and we've had good outcomes in 544 patients and poor outcomes in 40 cases, that is 6.8%. So we look, that is a very high rate of outcomes. No surgery also gives us a 93.2% success rate. Usually surgeries will be, the different literature say anywhere between 60 to 90% of good outcomes. So I looked at what were our poor outcomes. And so some of the poor outcomes were regular discs. 8 of them needed surgery. Of the 584 patients, only 8 needed surgery. So it literally took away pain in and gave tremendous relief to patients, followed up from anywhere between 6 months to 6 years in our experience. And only 8 of them have really needed surgery after root block. There were some who had a very doubtful disc, but as a diagnostic tool, we did a root block, and there 8 of them failed to get relief. There were some patients who had calcified discs, and as you know, the steroid wouldn't work on if there is a very hard disc, and with continued compression, there would be severe compression, there would be symptoms which manifest even at a later date. Post-surgical, of the 20 patients that are given in post-surgically, 12 of them had poor outcomes. Those are mainly for epidural fibrosis, and they kept having pain, and that went down only with long-term medications. And there were, of 24 patients who had spondylolisthesis, 8 of them failed, and we had to undergo, put them through a surgery. But 16 of them improved. So normally spondylolisthesis is something most patients need surgery, need a fixation and fusion. But I have found that if we give an epidural a selective nerve root block, then there is a good chance of them improving and getting long-term relief. So what does the literature say? The literature also concurs with our findings, that is, the therapeutic efficacy of SNRP is found to be very good, and it has prevented surgical intervention even in patients who have had a very clear indication for surgery. Patients who have, whom I have offered surgery, and they have said, no, we do not want surgery, try anything else, and we've given root blocks, and they have got long-term relief. So that's a very interesting finding. So I think we underuse selective nerve root blocks. I think we should use it more often for the benefit of the patients, so that they get good benefit from a very simple, low risk, almost no risk procedure, which is an outpatient procedure. So in a scenario like this, if you can see here, there is a large disc herniation with severe compression in the axial sections. The disc is occupying the spinal canal so much, usually need a surgery. The confusing ones are this scenario where there's a small disc bulge, and most of these improve with medications and with a SNRP. There is another concept, and that is that of auto-resorption. So people, patients ask me, doctor, will the disc go back to its original position if left alone? And my answer to them is no, it never goes back to its original position. But there can be auto resorption, that is, the body itself can send macrophages there and remodel the disc. It's not that it's being pushed back, but it can kind of trim the bulged part, the herniated part, making it a smaller herniation. This was one of my patients, 2 years follow up with conservative treatment at the same level. There is significant improvement in the amount of disc herniation. It has auto resolved. And that's a very interesting finding. So it's said to be due to neovascularization and the infiltration of macrophages, which lead to an absorptive reaction. And some studies have found it in 35% of cases and some others even in 100% of cases, which is very, very interesting finding. So to conclude, selective nerve root block is an effective and less invasive intervention and serves as an adjunct to non-operative treatment in case of lumbar nerve root compression, secondary to a lumbar disc herniation. So the message is very clear, and that is, if there is a patient who doesn't have any neurological deficits, who does not have any bowel or bladder involvement, then such individuals will definitely benefit from selective nerve root block. So if there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. If there's anybody who wants to ask any questions, you can ask the questions on the live chat. If there are no questions, we could end this session now. Thank you very much.